It's Ramsey Dewey over here in Shanghai, China. Welcome to another edition of Q&A with the Coach. Shout out to xmarshall.com for this sweet t-shirt. Get your own at xmarshall.com. And hey, use my code Ramsey10 for 10% off literally everything on their website. They don't just make t-shirts, but they make all kinds of training gear. It's awesome. Great designs to choose from. Go check them out. Again, that code is Ramsey10 for 10% off everything at xmarshall.com. If you have questions for the next edition of Q&A with the Coach, leave them in the comments down below. I read your questions. Our friend CyborgChicken3502 left a comment on a video about the Ultimate Self-Defense Championship. Go check that out on the Martial Arts Journey channel with our friend Rokas. Some interesting stuff over there. And he has a question about cauliflower ear. He says, by the way, Coach, I have a question. How prominent is cauliflower ear in judo and jiu-jitsu? And is it as common as it is in catch wrestling? Are there ways to prevent cauliflower ear from occurring in grappling sports? Cauliflower ear happens to some people. It doesn't happen to others. I've been grappling for almost 2 decades. And the most cauliflower ear I ever got was this tiny little almost imperceptible bud at the tip of my ear. I can feel it. It's just a little hard nub. You can't really see it. It's just a little hard calcified nub up there. That is all the cauliflower ear I have ever gotten in almost 20 years of grappling. So if you were trying to measure how good somebody is at grappling by how messed up their ears are, that's not a great metric. There are people who suck who have cauliflower ear. All you have to do is have a genetic predisposition to getting cauliflower ear. I had a student, a guy named Jomar. He wrestled throughout high school and college, and he never had a problem with his ears. He put a gi on for the first time. His first Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu class, and suddenly, the ears start swelling up because something about the fabric rubbing across the ear aggravated it in a way that wrestling without the gi did not. Some guys get their faces and their ears ground into the dirt and get their ears rolled over and squished and bent and damaged, and that can lead to cauliflower ear and deformation of the ear. So if you're a superior grappler, especially early on, and you avoid that kind of damage, you might not ever get it. I've had my ears twisted and crumpled and all of this, and they're pretty resilient. Man, look at these things. Could practically fly away with these things like Dumbo the flying elephant, but man, some guys get it, some guys don't. How do you prevent it? If you are susceptible to cauliflower ear, you can wear ear guards. That's the simplest, most obvious solution. Get yourself some wrestling ear guards. Now, I find, as far as submission grappling goes, wrestling ear guards can be pretty aggravating for the other guys. While they may protect your ears, that hard plastic casing can scratch up other people. As an alternative to that, if you want something lighter, smaller, the headgear they wear for water polo actually works really well for submission grappling if you're susceptible to cauliflower ear damage and you want to minimize that. It's softer, it's thinner, it's more fabric-based. You can squish your head against a guy and it's not going to cut or scratch him or leave him with any serious damage to his face or his ear. I mean, I've had people smack me in the head with those plastic, hard plastic coverings from their wrestling headgear, cause cuts and scrapes and black eyes and all kinds of damage to my face while trying to protect their own. So I don't think it's a great design, to be honest. It's a very long-standing traditional design that does work to protect your ears, but I don't think it's a great design for the other guys. So if you completely lack empathy for the other guys, okay, you're going to do what you're going to do anyway. But the water polo headgear, I have had some students who bought that and wore it for submission grappling, and that was nice to be on the receiving end of when, because there's a lot of close head-on-head, ear-on-ear, temple-on-temple, face, forehead-on-chin sort of contact in wrestling and submission grappling, in jiu-jitsu and judo and in catch-as-catch-can, etc. And if you have anything abrasive on your head, this can be a big problem. Anyway, Some guys get it, some guys don't. If your ear does start to swell up, you can drain them with a syringe. You've got to find someone who's experienced at doing it. Maybe don't trust the guy who's like, I've never done this before, but let's give it a try. Find someone with a little bit of experience who knows how to operate a syringe before you get those things drained, if that's the road you're going to go down. Man, I remember I had a student once. He started developing cauliflower ear pretty early on, and he went to a doctor, a Chinese doctor, and they put a plaster cast over his ear, an actual plaster cast over his ear. You know, like you would put a plaster cast over a broken arm, and this was over his ear, and it was the funniest looking thing. I was like, I've never seen anybody attempt to treat cauliflower ear like that. And he said, well, the doctor just wanted to make sure that my ear didn't take any additional damage. Which it didn't, and eventually the cast came off and the swelling went down, and he was okay, and he never got a bad case of cauliflower ear. So it is preventable to a certain degree, but at the same time, if it happens, it happens. Nobody gets out of this world alive, so trying to make it to the grave in perfect condition, what's that all about, guys? I want to leave this world chewed up, spit out, and full of holes. Thank you for watching. Now get out there and train.